Internet Paradigm 4, Hyperreality Simulation Spectacle. So, in this lecture, we are building on everything we've discussed so far in the previous 3 weeks, and when it comes to the Internet Paradigm, and we're trying to chart some interesting trajectories of where things might be going, and our exploration starts not with the internet, but a few decades earlier. And the thinkers that we'll be discussing in this lecture, which are Guy Debord, Jean Baudrillard, and Gilles Deleuze, are all in one way or another relevant to the internet paradigm, as you will discover. So we should be thinking of the concepts we're discussing in this lecture as provocations, as stinking aids about the phenomena that we're observing today and the phenomena that are about to emerge when it comes to the internet and the development of emergent media in general. As usual, we're starting with a rewind, after which we will jump straight into Guy Debord's notion of societies, of society of the spectacle. From there, we'll move to Guy Debord's, Jean Baudrillard's idea of the hyperreal, and then we'll finish with Gilles Deleuze's notion of societies of control. All right, so our departure point, as usual, in the rewind section is this idea that we've been discussing over the past two lectures, which is the notion of framing and the way events emerge and unnoticed by us in perception through the deployment of frames, which in turn allow us to generate stories. So we have this phenomenon of events, real or imagined, emerging out of the chaos of information stimuli as a story, as something coherent and conceivable with the help of a perception frame being deployed. So this is how we start. And we also discussed in the previous lecture this, the notion of frame in the context of how framing actually counterintuitively to an extent is predates the emergence of the event, right? So the event is secondary, it occurs after the frame is being deployed. Why? Because we need a frame of perception to be deployed in order for us to be able to discern, isolate simulae and discern them into some sort of coherent narrative about that event. So our interpretations of external stimuli are reliant on that frame built from previous experiences and knowledge stored in memory. We also talked about this notion of knowledge stored in memory as in effect schema, right? So what a schema? We discussed this in detail in the previous lecture. So I'm just giving you a brief overview now as a reminder. So starting in early childhood, we store external stimuli in memory as patterns of experiences, and this is something something our mind is doing as a way of building shortcuts to processing information that bombarding our perception. Over time, these patterns of experiences, when they repeat, stabilize in memory as association chains, right? So repeating patterns are stabilized as chains of associations. And these association chains, in turn, form schema. When we encounter external stimuli, these external stimuli are mapped by our minds directly to existing schema. And this is the role of schema to help the mind in the processing of a chaotic and complex reality, right? So this is a shortcut again. So the mind maps external stimuli to existing schema. And this in itself is a really important process to understand, because this is the exploit, to use a coding word, coding jargon, this is an exploit to the way the mind sees reality. This is an exploit that is used by virtually all media to alter the perception of reality. How can this perception of reality be altered? Existing schema can be changed by altering the association chains that form it, right? By adding or removing elements from those association chains. And therefore, the perceptual frame that we deploy in order to construct narratives about reality and to observe, to see events in the first place, is emergent out of schema, right? So schema are the building blocks of perception, the building blocks of reality, as it were. And we also discussed how because schema is any pattern of relationships, associative chains in effect in the mind, any set of nodes and links between them in the spider web of memory can be retrieved and used more or less as a single unit, right? So this is the shortcut. The key factor in transferring information from short-term to long-term memory is the development of associations between the new information and schema already available in memory. We talked about how, we analyzed the way the mind processes reality and stores repeating patterns as schema and then uses schema to speed up the processing of new stimuli. But we also looked at the other side of this process, which is the process of creating frames which would be able to influence schema. Right, so this is the media building process, if you will, and we identified that the key elements in this process are this notion of selection and salience. Right, so to frame is to select some aspects of a perceived reality and make them more salient in a communicating text. Right, so you isolate certain elements of reality and make them more salient, organize them in a way in which you will be able to connect them directly to the associative chains in your audience's mind, right, to their schema. So framing in that context is a central organizing idea or storyline that simplifies the volume and complexity of information stimuli, classifies this perceived reality through selection and salience, and therefore provides meaning, right? So framing is a meaning building exercise in this context. And we also discussed how, and we explored different examples, how in order to build a new frame, we have to use elements from schema already existing in an audience's mind, right? So selection, mapping the elements we use to build the schema to the elements already existing in audience's mind and arranging them in a new way in order to build salience. Why is that important to understand? Because you cannot build a frame which will be persuasive for an audience if the building elements of that frame are not mapping to schema in your audience's mind. Right, if the schema, the elements, the schema that you're using are not recognizable by your audience. So if that happens, if you're using some foreign schema to your audience, your frame will be either inconceivable and your audience will be unable to understand it and grasp it, or your audience will understand it and grasp it in a way which you do not intend. Right, so we identify this as the key element of that process, right? Building the selection and salience by mapping the elements of your frame, the building blocks of your frame, to schema already existing in your audience's mind. We also talked about how media framing can be used to create massive changes in perception of reality, and how the media is doing it in effect. And this quote by Edelman really captures this process very well. The character, causes, and consequences of any phenomenon become radically different as changes are made in what is prominently displayed, so selection and salience, what is repressed, and especially in how observations are classified. So there is a kaleidoscope of potential realities, right? So this is the chaos that we talked about in the earlier graph. Any of which can be readily evoked by altering the ways in which observations are framed and categorized. So out of that chaos, any of a number of potential realities can be invoked as real, And this is really important because we will be returning this to this notion of the real down the track in the lecture. So a number of potential realities can be evoked as real by altering the ways in which observations are framed, by modulating frames, by modulating what elements are constituent of the mass media frame, for example, right? So this obviously directly leads us to this notion of propaganda. We've already been talking about propaganda over the past few lectures. It's crucial to remember that propaganda is all about a consistent, enduring effort to create or shape events, right? So consistency and continuity over time, right? So you have repetition of carefully constructed, internally coherent, consistent imagery over time. And this is your recognizing, if you will, a pattern to discern propaganda. Creating pictures in the minds of millions of persons, regimenting the public mind every bit as much as an army regiments the bodies of its soldiers. So we have pictures which regiment the mind. Pictures created in the minds of millions of persons, in the minds of the audience. What does regimentation mean? Regimentation means creating and controlling patterns of behavior, right? That's what regimentation is in this context. Creating patterns and controlling them, right? So what does controlling mean in this context? It stands for the ability to modulate these patterns at will by injecting new stimuli, by injecting new images, new pictures in the minds of millions of persons. And we'll return to this idea down the track in the lecture. So we have coherent bombardment of the audience with imagery, repeating imagery, which is internally coherent and systematic, offering a systemic frame for interpreting reality, which relies on certain basic patterns which are repeating continuously, and obviously tailored to the specific media that are being used to spread it. All right. So by means of building to our starting point for the lecture, to our departure point, I also wanted to quickly touch on Ferdinand de Saussure, who is obviously the person, the media theorist and linguist and semiotician who developed the modern notion of the sign, right? As being constituted by a signifier and a signified. So very quickly, and chances are that most of you, if not all of you, are already familiar with this, but it's important to remember this for what comes next. So what is the sign, according to Saussure and modern semiotics? So a sign consists of two elements, a signifier and a signified. Importantly, the two elements, when brought together, constitute the sign. There is no sign without these two elements, right? So they're two parts of a whole. The signifier is obviously the image or element of reality which the mind focuses on, and the signified is the emergent pattern of associations, you could think of it that way, that this specific element of reality generates in the mind of the viewer, right? So the two together create a sign. This is important because this indicates, if you have been paying attention so far, exploit that is being used by media as well, and a way to generate new modes of perception and a way to alter existing modes of perception. And again, a classic example of a sign, you have a symbol that chances are all of you recognize immediately. The question you need to be asking yourself is, why do you recognize it immediately? Why do you know immediately what this symbol stands for, what this sign signifies? Why do you know that? And if you've been paying attention so far, you should be able to answer this by observing how carefully certain schema have been implanted in your mind and have been stabilized in your memory as chains of associations, right? So chances are you know this sign not only by the specific brand it's associated with, you also recognize it as a certain tagline, right? As a certain set of words, which in turn generates and evokes a certain chain of associations. So this is an example of a really successful positioning of a sign, right? Of just a mere image in the mind of millions of users, right? Regimenting them to generate a specific, carefully controlled pattern of associations. Now, this is really important because chances are, again, that most of you, when thinking about this notion of propaganda or this notion of manipulating the minds of audiences, evoke images such as, you know, Stalin or Hitler or some sort of universally recognized examples of propaganda as something that harms the public mind, right? That harms users. But that's not the case at all, and that's not at all what Bernays meant, right? These are, you could say, niche extremes. What Bernays meant by propaganda is what you're looking at right now, right? This is actually an excellent example of what Bernays meant by propaganda, regimenting the public mind, right? The chances, the fact that all of you virtually who look at this image recognize it as the brand associated with a specific company and straight away can think of the logo. In fact, this is usually the first thing you would think of the tagline, tells you how successful this process of regimentation is, right? And how far-reaching its consequences when it comes to positioning certain chains of associations in the mind of the users. All right, so with that, out of the way, now let's move to Gilles Deleuze's notion of the society of the spectacle. So who was Gilles Deleuze? Gilles Deleuze was a French philosopher, media theorist. You could probably call him an activist, although I'm not sure he would have liked this description of himself. He was all around, you could say, heretical thinker who he didn't really like being associated with any established forms of philosophy or any established political directions. He liked to chart his own path, as you will see. And he's really interesting from our perspective because he was one of the first after the Second World War period, one of the first thinkers to form a coherent critique of what was happening to the West and to the world at large, and to try and describe tactics for resisting what was happening. So he's the founder of a movement. This was an artistic slash political movement called the Situationist International, which started basically with his group of friends and fellow thinkers and artists. It started in the early 50s, and its heyday was probably these two decades, the 50s and the 60s. And they are very famous. They're probably most famous and recognizable for two specific concepts that they developed, and that Debord was the originator of, dérivé and détournement. And we will focus a little bit on both so that you understand the context from where the notion of the society of the spectacle comes from. So dérivé, let's talk about that first. So the key question that Debord and the Situationists asked was when faced when this rapid advancement of that form of industrial society, the industrial paradigm, encroaching on everything they recognized as a traditional lived culture. So the question was, what do you do when you're faced with this monolith, this totalizing force that erases all tradition, that erases all lived and local and unique, and imposes an industrial urban landscape which is always already totalizing, and it's always already homogeneous, right? And you can recognize it across the world when you see it. So the question was how to combat this, how to combat the boredom and kind of soul crushing experience of the modern industrial society. So when they talk about that, they were thinking of suburbia, they were thinking of the way the industrial urban landscape erases any difference, and so think in terms of how a central business district in any given Western civilization or Asian civilization or anywhere on the globe for that matter looks identical, right? So think in terms of those glass monstrosities. So this is what they were thinking of when describing the industrial and urban landscape. So how to combat that? So they came up with this concept of derive, which in a way stands for strategic drifting through that urban landscape and denying it the ability to frame your mind and your agency and your being into that mode of thinking that it requires. So there are many examples that you can find online. This is probably my favorite of derive. So this is a card game developed by a collective called Nowhere Nowhere. So check them out, nowhere-nowhere.org. I highly recommend this is a game that you should all experiment with. So here is an example of a set of cards. These are the get lost cards. So, you know, take them up, close your eyes, point out a place to go, or walk right, or walk left, or walk to the next park. So this is what the situationist would be doing as well in order to rediscover the lived space of the city, to populate the homogeneous desert of the industrial urban landscape with lived experiences. So these are the get lost cards, walk to the next mountain or hill, etc. So the next set is action cards. So you lower your speed or hurry up or make a field record to collect items, make snapshots, walk into the next house, find a place to party, etc., etc. Right? So you can draw them and try and enact them. And here you have the perception cards. Does the location remind you of something? Draw your own map of the area. Describe what you see on the ground. Describe when and where the area has changed, etc., etc. So this is a way to strategically drift through space, which denies that industrial urban space the ability to regiment your mind, right? So you are reinforcing a lived experience on that dead desert space. The second concept is détournement, which stands for a reaction that the situationist, or a set of tactical and strategic actions, to put it better, that the situationist international developed in their strategy of resisting propaganda, right? So the premise here is that industrial society and industrial media, what we've been calling legacy media, basically inject a continuous and never-ending stream of propaganda across all possible channels into the public's perception. And that propaganda has to be resisted, right? Because if you are not resisting it, it ends up regimenting your mind automatically. So the question is how to resist, how to combat this totalizing propaganda. And the answer was détournement, which is a hijacking and subverting of that consumerist propaganda. And you know, this is one example of many possible examples where the imagery of propaganda is, if you will, hacked subverted to act against it, to subvert the message of propaganda. And the argument that Debord developed in this context is that propaganda is powerless to deal with this form of hacking, if you will, because it does not recognize it, because all it sees is its own messages, right? And it obviously is not going to fight its own messages, even though these messages are hacked against it. So if you have been paying attention so far, you should recognize that this is a form of memetic warfare. Quite an early example from the 1950s of memetic warfare. Here you have a more recent example, but this is exactly what détournement is all about. it's a form of mimetic subversion of a dominant message. In this case, this is the dominant message of consumerist society. So we have this notion of derive and detournement, and the situation is international. And in the late 60s, Debord writes this book, Society of the Spectacle, which ends up being his most popular book and the book that he's remembered for, the concept that he's remembered for the most. This is a special time in Europe and in the world, late 1960s, if you've been paying attention, you would know that this is, 1 year later, we have the Summer of Love, so-called, we have student revolution and all sorts of street battles happening in Paris, and the situation is a part of those, of course. We have, students occupying universities, the French government falling. This is the time, obviously, of the Beatles, of Woodstock, Jimi Hendrix, Rolling Stones, etc., right? So all of these so-called countercultural movements. And in this context, Guy Debord's work on the Society of the Spectacle was really prescient in many ways. And it's prescient even today. So when you're reading it, and it is a reading, a recommended reading for this lecture, when you're reading it, you should be looking at current events, you should be looking at the way reality operates today, and think back to 1967, where Debord wrote that, to appreciate the prescience here. Okay, so what is the Society of the Spectacle all about? Why is it relevant to us? So the premises of the book and of the argument that Debord is building are first that modern reality in its entirety, so everything that we consider real, is mediated by images, by imagery circulating as reality. This is important. We will return to this down the track in the lecture. Second, that industrial society as we know it has as its singular role to generate a synthetic, as described by Debord, a synthetic form of life, which means an artificial form of life, consumerism, which in and of itself is utterly devoid of meaning, because its only meaning is to further consumerism, right? To exist is to consume. This is the motto of modern society, as Debord saw it. And consumerism, in turn, is driven by the actions of advertising and the mass media, the legacy media, as we know. So this is the contextual premise of the book. And the book is organized in these short sections, which are numbered. And this is the opening section. In societies where modern conditions of production prevail, life is presented as an immense accumulation of spectacles. Everything that was directly lived is now merely represented in the distance. Right? Key moment, everything that was directly lived. So there was a way of living directly. So this is the traditional society that Debord still remembered. This is the pre-modern, if you will, or pre-industrial or pre-mass media society, which was, according to the situation, is directly lived. It gave the opportunity to experience life directly. So this has now been substituted by a mode of living or by a reality which is merely represented in the distance. So it's always already mediated in the distance. It's not reachable, right? It is carefully constructed to be that way because it is part of the spectacle, right? It's an immense accumulation of spectacles. When the real world is transformed into mere images, because as we established, images are basically the constituent elements of the real world, according to Debord, mere images become real beings. Dynamic figments that provide the direct motivations for hypnotic behavior. And now, this is one of the essential elements of the notion of the Society of the Spectacle, that this notion that images end up acting as real beings, as agents, if you will, with their own agency. able to change minds and actions, right? And we already described in previous lectures how this is actually done, how this operates in practice, right? Mere images become real beings, which provide the direct motivations for hypnotic behavior. Now, this is interesting. What did he mean by that? And when Debord talks about hypnotic behavior and direct motivations for hypnotic behavior, he talks of this experience. This is the experience of which all of us are familiar with, because all of us have grown already in this, have lived all of our lives in a society of the spectacle, populated by images which are real beings. So think of these artifacts that I have on the screen, or any other, for example, for that matter, that you can think of. But these are quite popular, and I've put them there for a reason, because through the patterns of behavior, through the frames that have been deployed in these images which have become real beings, a certain set of actions, certain set of motivations are being adopted by the users, by us, by the audiences, is a form of behavior. And this is hypnotic behavior, because it's not, does not originate from us. It originates from these images, right? So in effect, our behavior is a mirroring, a hypnotic mirroring, like we are hypnotized, literally, according to Debord, in mirroring these patterns of synthetic behavior, right? And reproducing them in real time. These images, when they're detached from every aspect of life, according to Debord, they merge into a common stream. And so, and this stream, in turn, is what forms the society of the spectacle. It's a separate, sealed world that can only be looked at, right? It's a world of appearances, which is synthetic, right? It's artificial, and it cannot be lived, right? It can only be looked at. And this is really important to understand. And this lecture is definitely not going to be enough for you to really grasp what Debord meant. So I highly recommend you go through his book, at least the first half, in order to understand the implications of what he's pointing at, right? There's a paradigm shift in the modality of being when it comes to the emergence of mass media, the emergence of the totalizing circulation of homogeneous imagery, and patterns of behavior and patterns of thinking, which he describes as hypnotic. Which he describes as non-real. So the other element of this process is this notion of appearances and the shift from having to appearing. So the present stage in which social life has become completely dominated by the accumulated productions of the economy is bringing about a general shift from having to appearing. All having must now derive its immediate prestige and its ultimate purpose from appearances, right? If you recall, in so you have several possible stages of being here on a material level, and the most basic, if you will, is the utilitarian way of being, which says that, you know, you accumulate resources because you need them, right? The secondary level, you could describe it in this way, the level emerging with modern society is this notion of consumption society, consumption culture, which is all about having, right? So accumulation for the sake of accumulation. But Debord is pointing to something else here, right? So it's not about accumulation for the sake of accumulation, not about buying for the sake of buying, not about having for the sake of having. It's about having for the sake of appearing to have, right? So the entire reasoning, the entire meaning behind the process of accumulation in a consumption-driven society, according to Debord, is to be seen by others that you are doing this, right? It's consumption for the sake of appearances. It's conspicuous consumption, right? Consumption so that others might see your act of consumption, right? Think in these terms, right? So we have on the left, you have your classic Instagram image of someone on a beach, but being there on that beach, on that pristine piece of nature, it's not about just being there. It's not about having that experience, right? It's about being seen to be there, as you can see in the second image, which is basically illustrates to you the insanity and absolute, you could say, inhuman nature of this this synthetic experience, because it's you can see that process of someone capturing the same image, if you will, in three separate occasions in this one picture, which is all about, you remember how we talked about regimenting the public mind and patterns of replication, right? So we have certain patterns of behavior being replicated again and again and again and again. Right? So this is how propaganda works. This is how powerful propaganda can be. This is why I keep saying in the lectures, the best memes are never funny, because here you have a really powerful meme in operation. And it's right here. All having must now derive its immediate prestige and its ultimate purpose from appearances. So it's not about having that experience, but it's about being seen by others to have it, being recognized as having it by others. So in the society of the spectacle, according to Debord, the way Debord describes it, meaning and purpose can only be acquired through the conspicuous act of consumption. So meaning derives and purpose derives from the appearance of consuming, the act of being seen by others as consuming. So when you think this through, you realize how empty this mode of being is, right? It's devoid of any actual meaning. It's a pattern of endless consumption, which is driven by the desire to be seen as consuming. It's not enough to consume, right? It's not so much I shop, therefore I am. It is I am seen to shop, therefore I am. It's important to generate the appearance of consuming in the eyes of others. And it's all about the spectacle. When you think about the society of the spectacle in this context, this is the key element here, right? So how to generate those appearances in the eyes of others, and the battle of appearances, right? This is what the essence of the society of the spectacle is. So here you have an example, and this is an ad probably familiar to all of you, an example of how buying an item, in this case a computer, a computing device, right? So you could think of this as a very utilitarian purchase, but here you're buying that item not because of the inherent qualities of the device, or not because of the simple desire to hoard appliances, but you're buying it in order to buy the appearance of creativity.
And I'm a PC. You know, I actually just finished a home movie.
That's so funny, I just finished my own home movie. I did it on iMovie, it was really easy.
Well, I doubt it's as excellent as mine, but I'd be happy to take a look.
Yeah, that would be great.
Roll it.
Hi, I'm a mech home movie.
That looks really professional, right?
Well, great. Bye.
Wait. What about you, Squeezy?
Please.
Well, okay, sure. What's up, PC home movie? Work in progress?
Here you have another example. In this case, this is an ad for a car. And the key element in here is not the act of consumption of, you know, just simply buying a car, or the act of association or when it comes to associating the car with a price tag, for example, or associating the car with its actual specs, such as, you know, engine power and speed, etc. It is about the act of association of the car with the appearance of freedom, right? Which is a a precise illustration of the point that Debord is making, that when it comes to conspicuous consumption, right? So you are buying this car so that you can be seen by others as being free, right? You're buying literally the appearance of freedom. So when it comes to the society of the spectacle, and keep in mind that in 1967, when Debord was describing it, he saw it as already complete and firmly in place, right? So he wasn't predicting the arrival of the society of the spectacle. He was describing its finished form, as it were. So living is the production and consumption of spectacle. Literally, the act of being is the act of participating in the expansion of spectacle. Right, both by consuming and producing it, right? So you're consuming the spectacle generated by others, the appearance is generated by others, and in return you're producing your own spectacular image objects, as Debord would describe them, right? And in a continuous chain of continuous expansion of these spectacular image objects, like to infinity, expansions to infinity. So here is a description of that society. Understood in its totality, the spectacle is both the result and the goal of the dominant mode of production. It's not a mere decoration added to the real world, right? So it's not that you have the real world and then society spectacle is on top of it. It's the very heart of this real society's unreality. You know, its particular manifestations, news, propaganda, advertising, entertainment. The spectacle represents the dominant model of life, right? So the spectacle is all there is, in effect. And when it comes to that society, the all there is, all that we actually produce, this is Debord's argument, is image objects. So we produce more spectacle, right? No, we don't produce real items. We don't produce computers and watches and phones and etc. etc. We produce spectacle image objects. As advanced economic sector that directly creates an ever increasing mass of image objects, the spectacle is the leading production of present day society. Right? So, spectacular image objects are image objects which generate this sort of appearance associations. Right? They generate a type of consumer-driven culture, right? So it's all about consumption, but it's about spectacular consumption. It's not about utilitarian consumption. It's about being seen to consume this specific chain of associations, right? Being part of a certain spectacular frame, right? A certain positioning of appearances, and being seen by others to be part of that. And the process, as Debord describes it, generates total alienation, right? So a vicious circle of isolation. So the very technologies of the society of the spectacle are based on isolation, and they contribute to that same isolation. So we talked already about this in the context of our analysis of broadcast media. So from cars to television, the goods that the spectacular system chooses to produce also serve it as weapons for constantly reinforcing the conditions that engender lonely crowds. So in effect, why is this happening, right? So Debord's analysis here is that the society of the spectacle has to break down any possible resistance to it, any groups or cultures or tribes or traditions that stand against it, because they generate their own meaning, right? Because this is actually a battle for meaning that he's describing. So any traditional culture, any traditional institutions that are able to generate their own meaning. So think of everything here from the family to the tribe to religious institutions, public institutions, unions, etc., etc. Insofar as they're able to generate their own meaning, they are targets for the society of the spectacle because they are competing for meaning with it, right? And the way the society of the spectacle fights with them is through alienation, through generating this continuous atomization of the public, so that there is no opportunity even to be together in opposition, right? So it generates a continuous and vicious circle of isolation, which is driven in effect by this act of consuming and being seen by others, and so being in competition with others for attention, right? So you're continuously, imagine yourself in the context of Instagram here, in competition with others for attention. So this is a totally alienating and isolating experience, as Debord describes, right? It is not an experience together. It's a singular, alienating, isolating experience, the lonely crowds. So these goods that the system produces are in effect reinforcing and continuously engendering the lonely crowds as a phenomenon. So let's reassess. We have the concept of the society of the spectacle as developed by Gilles Deleuze in 1967. Everything that was directly lived is now merely represented. So it's not directly experienced anymore, right? That avenue of being is denied to us by the society of the spectacle. It's all about representation. Images, in turn, because of that representation, images are reified and become real beings, generating hypnotic behavior in the masses. These images merge into a common stream, as this separate pseudo world that can only be looked at, and that forms the society of the spectacle. A general shift from having to appearing to have, right? Appearances are the dominant and primary goal of the society of the spectacle. And that is the primary production, basically, of this society, appearances. All right, so this is really important to get on board and to remember when we're diving into the second concept in this lecture, which is the notion of hyperreality as developed by Jean Baudrillard. It's really important because Baudrillard was building in many respects on the work of Debord. So Jean Baudrillard was a French philosopher and media theorist who passed away in 2007, and he was really famous for a few concepts that he developed, one of which is hyperreality, the other one is simulation and simulacra, and we will encounter all of these down the track in the lecture. The most famous book that he produced is Simulacra and Simulation, written in 1981. Here you have it as appearing as a frame in the first Matrix movie. So I highly recommend everyone watch this movie, because the movie directly references and builds on elements from Jean Baudrillard's book as a testament to its almost prophetic, if you will, power and prophetic ability to explain the main trajectories of our society and the reality we currently inhabit. So the major premises of simulacra and simulation and Baudrillard's work: we have a reality, we're inhabiting a reality which is mediated by images, so lived experience is untenable. Being is mediated by appearances, so this is something that Debord already postulated. The real as a concept, right, is perceived by audiences, by people, not as something tangible that can be negotiated with. its experience is perceived as a string of images, as a string of appearances. Right? As Debord pointed out already, it's perceived as representation somewhere in the distance. Right? It's a form of spectacle. Right? It cannot be experienced directly in a lived way, non-mediated. And more importantly, this was at the beginning of one of the primary things that Baudrillard argued, that media images actually end up forming a reality of their own, which is independent from any underlying reality. And it is this reality, in fact, that we are made to inhabit. And the reason why we cannot relate in any way to the real as such and to real lived experiences is because we are, in fact, not even inhabiting the real. We are inhabiting a completely fabricated synthetic world. Right? And this is, by the way, why elements from the book were used in and ideas from the book were used in the Matrix trilogy that I highly recommend all of you watch. So if you recall, when we talked about the sign, so this is an important reminder, we have the signifier, we have the signified, right? So the two together form the sign, and the signifier is something real, right? And the signified occurs in the viewer's mind. Now to understand Baudrillard's argument, you have to understand that this line separating the signifier from the signified, right, which is purely conceptual, obviously, because Saussure argued that the two exist together in the mind of the viewer. This line actually is not only real, but you have to imagine it as impossible to cross, right? The signified exists completely independently from the signifier. And in fact, the signifier generates its own fake synthetic signifiers. And we are inhabiting only the signified without being able to cross into the territory of the signifier. Now we will map how this works in practice. So from our purposes, the key elements of that book and why we are focusing actually on Baudrillard are his characteristics of the stages of the sign, right? So also known as the phases, the four phases of a sign, which he developed in his book Simulacra and Simulation. So we have the first, according to Baudrillard, the first phase, the primary, if you will, default stage of a sign is that of reflection, right? Where a sign, the image, represents some sort of basic reality by reflecting it. It could reflect it well or maybe not so well or poorly, but it can always be recognized as an effort to reflect a basic reality. So it is, in the jargon of the internet, it's a copy, right? So here you have a sign, an image representing some sort of basic reality. Here you have a medieval village somewhere in France, right? So a reflection, representation of a basic reality. When most people think of images, they think on this basic level. Right, so, but this is, according to Baudrillard, only the first phase or in the possible phases of a sign, or possible phases of an image. The second phase, which is really interesting already, is the phase of the mask. And according to Baudrillard, the phase of the mask is characterized by a process of occlusion, obfuscation, a cover-up of some sort of basic reality. So, the first stage, the phase of reflection, represents some sort of basic reality. It might represent it poorly, but there is still an effort to represent, there is still an effort to build some sort of equivocation. At the second phase, at the phase of masking, you have a conscious cover-up of a basic reality. So you have it's not a copy anymore, it's a perverted copy, right? It's not a direct copy of something basic underlining the image. It's a perversion of that. So here you have an example, and you can think of your own. There are many possible examples you could think of the phase of the mask. So you have some sort of flat, empty facade which has been painted to mask that emptiness, right? That homogeneity and banality of that facade, and it has been painted to look like a lively image of a block. So it covers up that banality, that emptiness, by perverting it, by masking it, by changing it. So think of the phase of the mask as that cover up. The third phase is even more interesting though, because it's the phase of illusion, which many people find it hard to distinguish from the phase of the mask. So illusion stands for substituting the absence of a basic reality, right? So in the first case, in the phase of masking, we have a basic reality which is there, but which needs to be changed in one way or another, masked, right? So think of that facade which had to be painted over in order to make it look more dynamic, more interesting. But in the illusion phase, we have a substitution, which covers up an absence. So imagine if that wall, that building was not even there in the first place. So we have the illusion basically is an image which pretends to be a copy. It pretends to be a reflection. So it's an image which pretends to be the first phase, but it is not, right? So it substitutes the absence of a basic reality. And here you have an example of that, right? So the illusion of that lived experience and the real cafe. So all of these objects are masks, in effect, which generate an illusion. Right? There is nothing, no there. So this, you can find this kind of shops everywhere, this kind of coffee shops in every shopping mall. Nothing makes them unique, but they pretend to be unique. There's nothing there apart from the basic homogeneous structure of the shopping mall. Here is another example of illusion, the substitution of an absence in order to generate the illusion of a basic reality.
To help families refinance their homes, to invest in things like high-tech manufacturing, see, I would never say these things, at least not in a public address, but someone else would. Someone like Jordan Peele.
It's sort of learning to recreate that person's face by looking at thousands of images over and over and over. Like a lot more research than you would think would go into making a goofy video or something like that.
Truly surprising for me. I was just really surprised.
I didn't do any after touching on that video. That was just using the technology that was available from the machine learning side.
You don't even have to know what GitHub is. You don't have to know how to program in Python. None of that matters. You pay somebody $20 and they'll create the thing for you. That's a bit of a game changer.
You know, the everyday person who deepfakes X video emerges in a Google search of your name, where for that person, it was almost impossible to debunk.
I don't think that's likely. I also don't think it's out of the question. And that is enough to keep me up at night. The margins are very, very thin. Last national election here in the US was 80,000 votes in 3 states. You don't have to fool tens of millions of people.
I don't think it's a big political issue during the course of the campaign. Think about a well-placed rumor before an IPO. I think a lot of these things were problems already. And so it's unclear to me how much machine learning really, you know, adds to those problems. I find it very difficult to sort of believe that there's something so uniquely devastating about video.
Right now, what we are focusing on is developing forensic techniques to protect world leaders from deepfakes. We are particularly worried about how the Donald Trumps, Theresa May, and Angela Merkels of the world, how their likeness will be used to disrupt elections and incite potential violence in countries by three.
So what's interesting here for our purposes is this concept that Baudrillard developed of the phase of the image as an illusion, substituting the absence of a basic reality, is illustrated so well by the emergence of deepfakes, right? Which are images, obviously without any connection to an existing basic reality. So, you know, that footage of Obama talking, saying these words actually does not lead to any real event where he has said these words, right? But that absence of a basic reality is being substituted by that phase of the image operating as an illusion, right? Pretending to be a reflection, right? Pretending to be a link to that base reality, right? So we have that phenomenon of illusion appearing. Now let's look at simulacra, which is the concept that that Baudrillard developed. And Baudrillard argued that the modern condition, as we experience it, as we live it now, and remember this was written in 1981. So he argued that the modern condition is characterized by the circulation of image objects which are simulating a basic real without bearing any relation to any sort of reality, any sort of underlying reality. So he called these images simulacra, right? So they simulate a basic real. They simulate the appearance and the existence of some sort of phase zero, which is not a reflection of a real, but is the real itself, right? But that real doesn't really exist at all, right? So this in effect is a simulation of a real, a hyperreal, as he described it. So here is an illustration of that concept using the parable of the cave from the Greek philosopher Plato. So remember, simulacrum bears no relation to any reality, right? It's a hyperreal.
Imagine prisoners that have spent their entire lives chained deep inside a cave. They have been chained so that they cannot see behind themselves, and they are forced to stare endlessly at the cave wall in front of them. Behind them, a fire is burning, and between the prisoners and the fire is a raised walkway. Now imagine that each day a menagerie of objects crosses the walkway. Animals and people carrying their wares to market. Their shapes create an intricate shadow play on the wall in front of the prisoners. This is the only world that the prisoners have ever known. The shadows and the echoes of unseen objects. Now, imagine that a prisoner is released. After some time adjusting to the blinding light, the free prisoner will begin to experience the world outside of the cave for the very first time. And it is like nothing he could have ever imagined. With his new perception of the world, the man will of course want to return to his friends to share his incredible discoveries. But the prisoners cannot recognize their own friend. He appears as all things do. His voice is a distorted echo, and his body is a grotesque shadow. They cannot understand his fantastic stories of the world outside of the cave. To them, it will never exist. This, of course, does not make the world outside of the cave any less real.
So, when you're thinking of the simulacrum, right, think of the experience of those people in the cave, for whom that experience is a basic real, right, and who are unaware and refuse, when confronted with that information, to accept that what they're experiencing is a hyperreal, it's a simulation, which bears no relation to any reality. One of them was able to experience a reality. And again, when the prisoner who experienced the real returned to share that information, he was rejected because of the persuasive power of the hyperreal, of that simulated reality. And here you have the essence of this concept of the simulacrum, right? It is, as described by Baudrillard, the generation by models of a real without origin or reality, a hyperreal. Right, so simulation is no longer that of a territory or a referential being or a substance, right? So this simulation does not relate to anything pre-existing, to some sort of originary model which is being simulated, right? It just pretends to be the real, right? So thinking back to the faces of the image, the simulacrum pretends to be phase zero, a direct, a real, right? Not a reflection, not a mask, not an illusion, a real itself, right? Giving the illusion of authenticity, while itself not bearing relation to any reality, in fact, right? While being completely synthetic, right? So here, again, think of Debord's notion of the society of the spectacle. Jean Baudrillard's go-to example when thinking of the hyperreal was Disney and the Disney World. He used Disney World as an example in the book of model of a real without origin or reality, right? Because Disney itself doesn't, the Disney World and, you know, the Disney castle, etc., does not relate to any underlying reality. It's not a reflection, it's not a copy, it's not a mask, it's not an illusion, right? When it comes to its representation and its relation to an underlying reality, it is a hyperreal, right? It's pretending to be the real thing, and hence you have that phrase also in American English, the real thing. This is authentic, this is real, right? And this is actually what Baudrillard described as the hyperreal. In another famous excerpt from this book, he talks about the hyperreal as the desert of the real itself, right? The territory no longer precedes the map, nor survives it, right? So there is no relationship of a map with a territory, right? The map being a representation, poor or good, or masking, or some sort of illusion of a territory, right? The map of an underlying territory, the map pretends to be the real. Henceforth, it's the map that precedes the territory, right? The precession of simulacra. It's the map that engenders the territory, the desert of the real itself. And again, it is what's really key to grasp here is this perversion of our relationship to reality as engendered by modern society, right? The society of the spectacle that Baudrillard is tangling with. This is the moment where his contribution comes to the fore. It's no longer a question of imitation or reduplication or even of parody. it's a question of substituting science of the real for the real itself, right? So you have a he's arguing that there is a substitution has taken place and is taking place continuously, where the real is being substituted, is changed for the science, for the a simulacra of the real, simulacra which pretends to be the real, authentic experience, lived being, while they're not. Here you have a longer piece by Japanese artist Keiichi Matsuda called Hyperreality that I think really captures very well the not only the key argument from Baudrillard, but also the direction where this argument is leading us, the direction where the concept of simulacra and the hyperreal is leading us. And this is slightly cyberpunkish, if you will, in its experience. But I really think it illustrates well the notion of the hyperreal. So let's take a look.
¿Has pensado en correr? Es saludable y eficiente.
Seguro que no hay más trabajos disponibles. Yo estudio para ser profesora y estoy haciendo mercados.
Y además puedes quedarte con los puntos de fidelización. Eres una noche afortunada. Tienes que confiar en la aplicación. Te sientes inspirada. Gracias. Chao.
¿Quién soy yo? No, eso no es lo que quiero decir. ¿Para dónde voy? No, puedo volver a empezar. Olvídalo.
Parece que alguien está intentando vulnerar su cuenta. Por favor, esté dentro, reinicio su dispositivo.
So I'll skip this, but the key moment from my perspective was that that frame where the entire simulation stopped, like it had to restart, and we could for a brief moment see the desert of the real, right? For a moment we could see how the actual real looked like, not the obfuscated hyper-real, right, which was a pure simulation, right? So this is key from our perspective, and you can see how Debord's notion of society of the spectacle organically leads to the appearance of a hyper-real, a layer of reality, and a hyper-real face when it comes to media, when it comes to the appearance of simulacra. And here you have a really interesting description from Baudrillard of what the hyperreal actually entails. So I will read it in full. To dissimulate is to feign not to have what one has. To simulate is to feign to have what one hasn't. One implies a presence, the other an absence. In this case, presence or absence of a reality, right? Some sort of underlining real. Someone who feigns an illness can simply go to bed and pretend he or she is ill. Someone who simulates an illness produces in himself some of the symptoms. Thus, feigning or dissimulating leaves the reality principle intact. There is some sort of relation to reality. The difference is always clear, it's all only masked. Whereas simulation threatens the difference between true and false, between real and imaginary. Since the simulator produces true symptoms, is he or she ill or not? Right? Is it real or not when it is producing the symptoms of a real, even though it doesn't have any actual relation to reality? Right? So this is the key dynamic here, and what is really unsettling and disruptive and in many respects horrifying about the appearance of the hyper-real. Right? So is Disneyland actually real at all when you think of it as simulating the true symptoms of a castle, of a lived experience, where in fact it's a purely synthetic, artificial, fake experience, right? Here is another example of the hyperreal in practice. So this example comes from a Japanese company called DataGrid, which produces AI-generated human models, right? So all the humans you will see in this and in the next video are generated by AI, right? So they resonate with this definition of the hyperreal from Baudrillard. The simulator produces true symptoms. So is it real or is it not, if the symptoms are true, right? So let's take a look. So all of these clothes and all of these humans that you see are entirely AI generated without any underlying imagery of real people, right? So they're completely synthetic humans. But are they real or not? Right, so this is what the hyperreal is. Here is another example from the same Japanese company. Again, these are AI-generated humans. So we have the simulation of a real, right? Not a representation of a real, it's a simulation of a real. In effect, a hyper-real. Another example is probably my favorite when it comes to AI-generated humans and the notion of the hyperreal, right? The generation by models of a real without original reality. A hyperreal is this website, thispersondoesnotexist.com. So I highly recommend all of you listening to or watching this lecture, go to this website and play with it. So that's thispersondoesnotexist.com. So just hit F5, hit refresh, reload your browser. So each and every image you will see is of an AI-generated, AI-rendered human being. So none of these human beings actually exist, right? None of the backgrounds actually exist. So these are fully synthetic beings, but they're hyper-real, right? So these images are made to appear as if they were taken in the most authentic of situations, right? They don't look synthetic at all, right? With the backgrounds, with the imperfections, and this is what makes them hyper-real, right? So they're simulated humans. When the real is no longer what it used to be, nostalgia assumes its full meaning. There is a proliferation of myths of origin and science of reality, of second-hand truth, objectivity and authenticity. There is an escalation of the true, of the lived experience, a resurrection of the figurative where the object and substance have disappeared. And there is a panic-stricken production of the real and the referential, above and parallel to the panic of material production. So Baudrillard is describing what happens when the hyperreal becomes the dominant mode of reality, right? His argument is that we live in a hyperreal now. And remember, this was written in 1981, 40 years ago. He's arguing that, and notice how prophetic he is in his argument, that nostalgia becomes a dominant experience, right? When the hyperreal is the dominant mode of being, nostalgia, right, the longing for the real, becomes a dominant experience. It assumes its full meaning. And therefore, you have a proliferation of myths of origin and science of reality, right? So the quest for the real becomes an overriding quest, right? So authenticity becomes a dominant meme, if you will, a dominant trope. Everything has to be authentic, right? The authentic experience is something to be desired, right? Is this real? Is this authentic? And so his argument is that these phenomena are appearing and they are to be expected because of the ascent full deployment of a hyperreal reality, right? A completely artificial synthetic reality which we all inhabit. A panic-stricken production of the real and the referential, right? A continuous chase after the authentic, a longing, right, as the dominant mode of being, right? Homesick for a place I'm not even sure exists. So this meme actually really well captures the experience of the hyperreal that Baudrillard mapped so well, right? When the real is no longer what it used to be, nostalgia assumes its full meaning. So let's reassess. We have this notion of simulacra and simulation, the notion of the appearance of the hyperreal as developed by Jean Baudrillard. The argument is that modern society is a simulated model of a real, and it's in fact a hyperreal without any underlying reality or relationship to any underlying reality. The hyperreal is populated by simulacra, which are images. Image objects, as Debord would call them, without any relation to the real, while simulating a real. And simulacra substitute science of the real, the authentic, for actual reality, right? And the end goal here, result is the appearance of the chase for the authentic and the feeling of nostalgia as dominant phenomena in this paradigm. All right, so moving on, the final concept that we want to explore is the concept of the society of control, as developed by French philosopher Gilles Deleuze. And again, I hope you'll be able to see how it builds and relates to and resonates with the concept of the society of the spectacle and the hyperreal. So Gilles Deleuze, French philosopher, critical theorist, and media theorist as well, most famous for his book A Thousand Plateaus, together with Félix Guattari, but for our purposes, a key book of his is Postscript on Societies of Control. It's a very short, it's not a book actually, it's a very short essay written in 1992, just a few years before he passed away. And it's a key text for us because in it he describes very well the emergent modern condition. So his argument there is really interesting. He argues, and building on the work of Foucault, we won't have time to go through the work of Foucault, but he's building on an argument of Foucault from a book called Discipline and Punished. And he's arguing that there used to be a stage in human development where we all lived in what he calls sovereign societies. Right? So when you think of sovereign societies, think of traditional cultures, think of the ancient world or medieval Europe. So these are sovereign spaces. So these societies produce sovereign spaces. Sovereign spaces are characterized by walls, by borders. You would recognize them as, for example, medieval cities or medieval castles or medieval villages. These are spaces which live in a sovereign state by separating themselves from their surroundings. So they are populated by people who are also sovereign. So sovereign bodies populate sovereign spaces. This forms a sovereign society, right? Which is organized around the principle of extraction of surplus value, right? So people produce some sort of value and sovereign societies extract that value. So from people, from families, from towns. And the key principle is my home is my castle, right? So you have the sovereign space as a key concept here. Sovereign spaces gave way with the Industrial Revolution to what Foucault and later Gilles Deleuze describe as disciplinary societies. Now, disciplinary societies are really interesting because this is the default mode of existence of industrial civilization. And its key recognizable element is the factory, a space of enclosure and discipline, space where not only labor, but being, the modes of being itself is organized along the principle of discipline, right? So disciplinary societies are characterized by such spaces such as schools and prisons and offices. Each space, in fact, that the disciplinary society will generate is a space of enclosure in discipline. So the one space that is probably familiar to everyone watching this lecture is this one. So we have here the school. And notice how everything about this space is organized around the principle of discipline, right? Principle of enclosure. The bodies are disciplined to sit in a certain way, behave in a certain way, face a certain way. Agency and all sorts of action is disciplined in the same way, right? So one can speak only when allowed by an authority figure. So this is what disciplinary modes of being actually look like, right? They're all in reference to an authority figure, right? And they all enact a certain set of patterns of behavior, a certain discipline. Same thing applies to factory floors, for example, right? So again, spaces of enclosure and discipline. The space itself is organized in such a way so as to order reality into discrete chunks, into manageable parts, and organize them into some sort of machine, right? Because that's what the key mode of the industrial society is, right? Is the assembly line. We already talked about this. The symbol and the organizing principle is the assembly line. So when you think about school, this was its entire purpose, to discipline and organize the modalities of being of everyone who passes through school into discrete elements for the machine, for the assembly line, into future obedient workers. So And this is where Deleuze's argument becomes really interesting. So he argues that we are inhabiting, and again, remember, this was written 30 years ago, we are inhabiting a generalized crisis of the disciplinary society. He argues that the disciplinary society, the societies of enclosure, the prison, the hospital, the factory, the school, the family, are all in a state of collapse, in a total degeneration and collapse, and that they are being substituted by a completely new mode of organization and being, the society of control. So the society of control is, according to Deleuze, the default mode of organization for civilizations built around the flow of information. And they are characterized, so just remember, you had sovereign societies, which are characterized by sovereign spaces. Then we have disciplinary societies, which are characterized by spaces of enclosure and discipline. And then we have control societies, which are characterized by control and modulation, where spaces are organized in a way where they can control flow and modulate the flow of information, because information societies produce primarily information. And insofar as humans operate within those societies, they operate first and foremost as information and second as humans, right? So while spaces of enclosure administer the humans within, spaces of control modulate what it means to be human, right? So, and think of this in terms of humans as primarily information. So depending on the needs of a certain space, control space, what it means to be human changes, right? Depending on the code that is being deployed. The extent and the depth and the potential enormity of what it means human is entirely a function of the algorithm that is being deployed in this specific space of control and modulation. And the classic example here is a border crossing at an airport. So this is from I think this was from Sydney airport, and you can see someone's who passes through this space of control and modulation is recognized first and foremost as a pattern, right? As a face in a database. And that face in a database is first and foremost a set of codes. It's a set of data. And based on the algorithm, that data is allowed to do certain things, such as cross into this space, into this country, or disallowed or precluded from crossing into, right? So the being of this human, the carrier of that face, the human with whom that specific string of data is associated, is entirely a function of the string of data, right? Not the other way around. So this is what the spaces of control and modulation actually stand for. Their project is all about, and their mode actually of operation is all about control and modulation of access. Right? Are you allowed, is this data allowed to be here and now on these terms or not, right? Think in terms of recommendation algorithms. This is a really good illustration of societies of control, because the data that you see, right, is entirely a function of an unknown logic by the algorithm, right? Unknown to you. And that reality that you see, this collection of items, for example, that the Amazon algorithm generates for you, such as a recommendation, or the Netflix algorithm or whatever, is unique to you. It does not exist independently from you in this configuration, right? It's unique to you, uniquely generated as a real, in effect, a hyperreal, building on Baudrillard's concept, for you. And why is that happening? Why is this reality, why is this set of data generated uniquely for you? Because of the past data that you have generated for that specific platform, for that specific database, right? So you have all you have in effect is interaction of data in a space of control and modulation, right? So the entire experience of being, the entire lived experience such as it is a function of this interaction of data, according to algorithmic logic. So this is the dominant, the operant mode of existence in a control society, and the symbol, the essential element is obviously code, it's data. And Deleuze's argument is that just like the factory was replaced by the corporation as a part of this shift to a control society, perpetual training replaces the other elements of the disciplinary society, such as the school, and continuous control replaces the examination, right? So, because remember, in the disciplinary society, the factory is there, and if something happens to the factory, a key element of that disciplinary society is affected. Whereas, if something happens to the offices of a global corporation in this country or in any other country, the global corporation in and of itself is not affected in any way, right? You have a completely different mode of being here. Just like in the school, the dominant mode of operation was one of disciplining the body and disciplining the mind. In a society of control, you have perpetual training, right? This notion of continuous schooling, the notion of continuous training, and again the meme that, you know, you will be changing your professions many times in the future and you need to be ready to learn continuously. So this is a dramatic shift away from the disciplining modes of industrial society. And the examination as the final mode in an industrial mode of education is replaced by continuous control, right? By continuous evaluation. And when it comes to societies of control, again, Deleuze argues that what is important is code, right? Because code as a emergent phenomenon when it comes to control societies is what algorithmic logic can work with. And you will notice from starting from next week onwards, we are discussing algorithmic logic. Is this the numerical language of control is made of codes that mark access to information or reject it, right? We don't have this phenomenon of the masses and the individuals anymore, he argues. We have codes, which can be, codes of permission, codes of denial, right? Access to information or rejection of access. And again, the classical example here is, the notion that, you cannot access this specific code, this specific string of data is unavailable to you. But that can be modulated and it can be made available to you, right? So the numerical language of control is made of codes that mark access to information or reject it. So we have control societies as a key emergent organizational mode of the information civilization. All right, everyone, that's it from me for today. I realized this was quite a handful, and we will be discussing the different concepts from this lecture in the tutorials down the track and in the following weeks. If you have any questions, as usual, hit me up on Twitter at TedMeetYou. And thank you for listening, and see you online.